Greetings, comrades! We all dreamed of being cosmonauts when we were kids, didn't we? Or astronauts, if you're from the United States, my dear follower. Right now, the path to becoming a cosmonaut is quite straightforward. In Russia today, the main requirements for those who want to get into the cosmonaut squad are age no more than 35, knowledge of one foreign language, no criminal record, and non-humanitarian higher education, engineering, biology, or medicine. And that's basically it. A bit of preparation and your dream has come true. But that's not how it was 60 years ago. Back then, the Soviet Union had to select a person who would later become one of the main figures of the entire 20th century. The face of a huge country. The first human in space. And today I will tell you how exactly he was picked and prepared. So, imagine you are Sergei Korolev. You dream of building a spaceship based on a ballistic rocket. And you succeed. You send a piece of metal into Earth's orbit, and then you send some animals there. And some of them even come back alive. You absolutely know what your next step is. You have to put a living human being on top of the rocket and send him into space. And make sure he comes back alive too. It would seem that if an ordinary mongrel was able to do it, then a man can do it too, right? But unfortunately, Belka and Strelka were in no hurry to share their secrets of how they made it through the day in Earth orbit. So in fact, Korolev was forced to act blindly. And he began by deciding to recruit the elite of the Soviet Air Force into his unit. Thousands of candidates. 20 squad members, 12 cosmonauts, one first man in space. The quest for candidates for the Soviet space program began in 1959 with the development of instructions for the selection of cosmonauts. In fact, almost the most important parameter in the selection process was the physical characteristics of potential applicants. Korolev immediately indicated the framework to be met by future cosmonauts: age below 30 years, height no more than 170 centimeters, weight up to 70 kilos. A man slightly bigger would simply be unable to properly fit in the Vostok 1 cabin. The space committee immediately defined the search areas. Cosmonauts were selected from fighter pilots, who were used to experiencing G-forces similar to those that were expected in space flights. Nobody knew the exact level of these forces, so only candidates with absolutely perfect health were chosen. About 3,500 people were reviewed, about 1,500 people were invited for examination, and by the fall of 1959, after numerous checks and medical examinations, 20 potential cosmonauts were selected. The best of the best. And the most interesting thing was that these people did not even know what they were being trained for. Here is a quote from one of the squad members, twice hero of the Soviet Union, Boris Volynov. There was no cosmonaut training center. There was no star city. There was a forest, there was barbed wire. We came and prepared for the unknown. When we asked questions, they went unanswered. But on the other hand, it was very interesting. And there was a special person, the chief who created the design bureau. No one knew his name. No one knew his last name. Everything was secret. We were secret. Actually, everything was done this way not because the USSR adored secrecy, although of course it did, but simply because even the leaders of the space program at that time had no idea how exactly they would prepare the cosmonauts. There was no information about how a space flight would affect a person, so it was decided to play it safe and just choose the toughest pilots. And make sure they could bring the execution of certain commands to automatism in conditions where at any moment something could go wrong. This way, they insured themselves against the failure of the entire Soviet space program. No special professional qualities were highlighted at that time, because the profession of a cosmonaut was brand new. Even doctors in the program were more worried not about physiological pressure, but psychological one. Soviet psychiatrists were afraid of possible random schizophrenic episodes among cosmonauts. So much so that the manual control of Vostok 1 was blocked until the very start on April 12, 1961. In order to activate manual control, Gagarin had to open a sealed envelope with a sheet of paper, which had a mathematical equation, which, when solved, gave him the code to unlock the control panel. This was a protection against the possibility that in case of a sudden insanity, the cosmonaut would be able to take over the controls of the ship and do something catastrophic on his own. And there were many, many other fears. Accordingly, after recruiting the necessary candidates, a certain set of tests and exercises was developed to prepare them for being in space. Let's take a look at them. According to Valinov, at first the future cosmonauts were not even told what exactly they would be doing in the next 2 years. The first exercises were on how to eject from the plane and use a parachute in a certain way. There were strictly defined conditions. Get out of the aircraft at an altitude of about 5 km and open the parachute only 800 meters from the ground. Every single cosmonaut had to pass this exam first. So, you taught potential cosmonauts how to correctly jump out in case of emergency situation in space. What's next? Send them to the prototype spacecraft? No. You send them off to study, study and study again, as Grandpa Lenin commanded. Let me remind you, the first cosmonauts were military pilots, people without higher education, and everything in cosmonautics is based on engineering knowledge. That is why they were sent to the Zhukovsky Academy, to improve their theoretical expertise. Future cosmonauts attended courses in astronomy and geophysics, aviation and space medicine, rocket engineering and flight dynamics, the construction of a spaceship and its many systems, and also learned to work with a video camera. And only after that they were finally allowed to attend practical training. However, at that time a spaceship was just being built, so future cosmonauts had to prepare for individual flights on an ordinary airplane. Training in a full-size model of the ship was approved only in 1961. Candidates had to undergo simulated 3-day flight in a spacesuit and without it, as well as to demonstrate skills of manual control of the ship in emergency mode before landing. In addition, cosmonauts had to participate in training flights on airplanes, parachute jumps, ascents in diving chambers, checks in thermal chambers, studies in a surda chamber, which was called Tower of Silence, a soundproof room of 2.5 to 2.5 meters. There were also vestibular studies and training, centrifuge training, flights in zero gravity and in-depth medical examinations. In fact, all of this training was not that difficult itself. Professional pilots should have been able to handle them with ease. Korolev, who personally supervised the training of cosmonauts, did not really monitor the cosmonauts' performance, but rather looked closely at their behavior during exercises. He had to figure out which of these 20 heroes was really worthy of the title of the best. Which one of them would be the first man in space? 6 months before the first flight, in October 1960, the first group of cosmonauts was divided into two parts. More precisely, 6 people were chosen. Those who began to train on a prototype of a spaceship Vostok in the Flight and Research Institute of Zhukovsky near Moscow. In 6 months, they had to familiarize themselves with the spaceship as if they have lived inside it all their lives. Gagarin, Titov, Nelyubov, Nikolaev, Bykovsky, Popovich. Any one of them could later become the number one man in space. But as you know, Yuri Gagarin became the one. Let's find out why. A couple of months before the flight, it became clear that only Gagarin, Titov and Nelyubov could realistically become number one. Individual spacesuits were created for those three. Each had a chance to become the first man in space, but even minor factors could have prevented this. Why Gagarin? The official version is simple. Yuri Gagarin was absolutely the best in all training metrics. German Titov also had brilliant grades, but was a little bit worse. The official version also says that the choice of Gagarin as number one happened right at the Cosmodrome during a meeting of the State Committee, which took place on April 8th. And on April 10th, its decision was announced to the cosmonauts. In fact, this is not entirely true. At least some documents have survived, such as the application for an attempt to set a record for the duration of the flight, submitted to the Aviation Sports Committee of the Central Aero Club of the USSR by Nikolai Kamanin, head of the Department for Preparation and Support of Space Flights of the Main Staff of the Air Force. It was submitted in March, and Gagarin's name was on it. So already then he was considered to be number one. Was he really the best among the cosmonauts? There is no doubt, Yuri Gagarin was a brilliant pilot and performed very well in all of the exercises. But still, for example, during flights in brief weightlessness, Gagarin received a good grade, while other members of the unit received an excellent mark and a commendation in their personal records. Moreover, according to the memoirs of some participants in those events, when Gagarin first joined the Cosmonaut Squadron, he did not really stand out much. The only thing that really set him apart was his natural curiosity. He always wanted to know every single detail about their future tasks and missions. But during the tests, another trait emerged that made him a favorite. Namely, during the experiments in the Surda chamber, a room cut off from the outside world in which it was necessary to spend several days. The members of the examination board noticed that he had a very good reaction to anything new. He did not panic at sudden signals, reacted quickly and correctly to them, and switched very quickly from a waking state to a dormant one. As I said before, the greatest fear of the USSR at that moment was the complete failure of this flight, and so they needed a man who could save the mission from disaster by his timely actions. Meanwhile, the most technically well-prepared cosmonaut, Titov, was sent on a longer and more difficult second flight, August 6, 1961. Nelyubov, on the other hand, never made it into space. He was expelled from the cosmonaut squadron in 1963 for violation of military discipline, and just 3 years later he died beneath the wheels of a train. There was much gossip and rumors surrounding the figure of Yuri Gagarin as the first man in space. People said that he got his place as the first cosmonaut just because he came from a working class environment and had a really charming smile. Allegedly, Nikita Khrushchev thought that Titov was too cultured to represent the Soviet Union to the international public properly, and to be the first Soviet cosmonaut. And, well, Nelyubov simply had too ugly of a last name for that. Perhaps there is some truth in this. At any rate, I can safely say that it was Gagarin's personal and psychological qualities, and not any outstanding technical knowledge, that made him the leader among the entire cosmonaut corps. Perhaps Titov or Nelyubov were indeed better at complex technical tasks. After all, Gagarin himself said about Titov in his memoirs. He was just as well trained as I was, and probably capable of more. Maybe they didn't send him on the first flight, saving him for the second, more difficult one. But consider the way those two behaved themselves after 1961. One, as I mentioned, got in a drunken argument with a military patrol and was dishonorably discharged. The other also had a big drinking problem and even accidentally killed his passenger while driving under influence in 1964. Could such people be the public face of a Soviet Union? So it's probably safe to say that the Soviet leadership's choice was 100% justified, and Yuri Gagarin was indeed the most worthy candidate for cosmonaut number one.